Shut up and sit down.
Podcast episode 211. I'm Jeigh.
I'm Adrian. We're back for another week of comic book, TV, maybe movies, definitely wrestling.
I got at least one movie to talk about.
Movies and wrestling
news. All
right.
Okay. To start out with, oh, there is something on the cap I didn't even notice, but I think that's normal, right?
That is gluten-free?
Yeah.
Yes. The majority of ciders are all gluten-free.
That's what I realized as soon as I said that. Okay.
So what are we drinking today, bud?
So we went a little adventurous tonight. We got from Seattle Cider Company their three pepper hard cider, which is it's their standard hard cider, but it's mixed with jalapeno, habanero, and poblano peppers.
I don't want to be rude, but the lid actually says not your standard cider.
Well, yes, in this its final form, it is not your standard cider. We've talked in the past about how, at least I have, I've kind of gotten bored with beer. Because it's the same six styles over and over and over with different labels on it. So I was walking through the beer store before I came out tonight and trying to find something a little different. So I came across this, and before I picked it up, I sent you a message. And I'm like, are you looking to go more safe tonight or more adventurous? And you told me adventurous.
I'm adventurous. It has been a long day. It's time for some adventure.
I'm a little worried at how pale this is.
So, you know, it's actually on the sweet side.
Okay.
It actually says it's it's sweet.
Okay. Like, so this is their semi-sweet cider, then, not their dry cider.
Yes. Okay. I actually tend to prefer the dry, but I think with the peppers, sweet's going to be the way to go. So let's
all right, let's do this
shot. Smells good.
Do you taste the pepper?
I do. It's okay. A very mild pepper.
Yeah.
It's more like apple juice that has a dash of cayenne.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what I'm getting.
I feel the pepper a little bit more in my chest than I did in my mouth.
Hmm. Okay.
All right.
Like, I'm not opposed to it. No. I'll drink it.
Yeah.
I think the issue I have with ciders, I enjoy them. I like them. I drink them too quickly, and then I get an upset stomach by from the amount of sugar.
Okay.
There's so much
sugar. I was going to say, you drinking your beers too quickly is a common problem, not just cider. But the sugar in the stomach, I can see that.
Have you noticed that I do tend to drink all my beers and my whiskey and my
ciders too quickly? I feel like the last seven drinks we've had on the show, you've been like, the problem with this is we drink it too quick. But I mean, you're talking, I mean, you got a cider, which is sweet. We had the AMFs, which go down pretty quick. We pounded the Irish car bombs, much like you're doing to this cider right now. So we're kind of on a roll of having drinks that you would consume quickly anyways.
But my cider's already gone.
It is.
The entire pint's gone.
It is. Let me work on mine. I think Price is right this because we've got a backup.
When you do that, a lot of pepper. Don't worry about it. I don't think I'm going to go for another one.
Okay.
I just did it more for the comedic value, but a lot of pepper.
There it is. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, I have second thoughts about you now. Three pepper.
You know what I was really hoping I would find, but I don't think they're making it again, was that mole. Remember the mole beer we had?
Yeah, I do.
That was delicious.
That was a good beer.
I was just talking to somebody about that last week. But
speaking of Frugal Brutal and beer, some news for you if you're listening. His favorite beer here is the Kitty Cat Blues.
Black Raven,
only available in the springtime.
Right, which if you go back to episode something before this, we tried it with him.
We did. I was going to buy him a case.
Okay.
Because that's what, you know, friends and nice people do.
Yeah.
Other friends of the show, I guess I'll buy you guys a case of beer too. But then, actually, some of you have bought more than a case. Matt, I've bought you way more than a case. They announced it's going to be a new year-round. It is so popular, they have now made it one of their year-round staples.
Do you think that's going to diminish the enjoyability of it?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Because I don't tend to get it. It's not readily available, and it's only a bomber.
Right.
Only some stores carry it. So I don't get it that frequently. And the prices on it vary so drastically depending on where you get it from.
Right, yeah.
So I got it at Whole Foods.
Okay.
And I also got it at Central Market in PCC. Or is it PC? I think it's PCC. Central Market was the most expensive at $7.99.
I'm not surprised by that.
PCC, $6.99. Whole Foods, $3.99.
Wow. That's quite the difference.
That's the one that blew my mind.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
So, yeah.
Awesome.
So, let's talk some TV.
Okay.
What do you got?
So, I watched the season 7 finale of Walking Dead. Girls, Arrow, Flash, Riverdale, all those regular ones. The first two episodes of Adam Carolla and his friends build stuff live.
Yes.
First episode, Jimmy Kimmel, they build a loft, like you would in a garage, something like that, to store things above your cars. Second episode, it's Adam Sandler, and they build a panic room.
Now, that one surprises me.
Because he's got a new movie coming out.
That's not the part that surprises me. Adam Carolla, because you and I both used to be big fans of his podcast, yeah, talked endless shit about Adam Sandler.
Oh, absolutely.
Endless.
But he's got a new show on. He needs to get people booked. So he's just going out to the talent agents. Hey, who do you have that
I guess,
you know,
yeah.
So that episode was funny. You could actually tell that they're doing this live. So one of the things they're doing, so they're turning a closet into a panic room, essentially.
Okay.
Reinforcing the inside of it so that if somebody breaks into your house with a sledgehammer, Triple H maybe, you can prevent him from getting in. So they're screwing down a piece of 3/4-inch ply to the inside of the door to reinforce it. They put 4 or 5 screws in, and Adam looks over, and he's like, shit, that's the wrong side of the door. So they had to unscrew it, flip the door over, and redo it. So you're like, okay, they're making mistakes. It's live. Good. Pretty enjoyable so far. There's only 3 episodes out. I think it comes on Thursday, so there'll be a 4th one tomorrow.
Did they metal enforce the ply? Because then I don't feel plywood would be just enough to be preventative in the panic room.
I don't know. It held up against a sledgehammer.
Did it?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
They may have done more to it that we didn't see.
But maybe. Yeah. Okay.
And then on Saturday, I watched Netflix Live, which, have you watched this yet?
No.
Okay. So we briefly talked about it on Sunday.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Is it still available? I thought it was only on April Fool's Day and it's been...
Oh.
I don't know if it's still up. I just assumed this. Go ahead.
I'm sure you could find it somewhere.
Okay.
So Saturday was April Fool's Day. Netflix's April Fool's prank was a show called Netflix Live, which was Will Arnett sitting in a studio in the Netflix headquarters and doing live commentary on things happening around the office. So at one point, somebody is sharpening pencils, and you're sitting there watching them hand crank the old style sharpen pencils. And Will Arnett's getting all upset because the guy will sharpen a pencil and put it up, and then he'll sharpen another one, and he'll put it up, and he'll straighten them. He'll square them up to each other, and he'll do another one and square them up to each other. And he's like, you can fucking straighten them at the end. You're wasting an entire day sharpening pencils. You see somebody spend 5 minutes trying to parallel park. Somebody puts a burrito in the microwave for 3.5 minutes, and he sits there and does commentary on it the entire time, talking about what could possibly be in that burrito. Like, is it chicken? Is it carne asada? If it's steak, 3.5 minutes might not be long enough because it's dense. But at the same time, I hope somebody's not trying to microwave steak right now. Super funny.
Okay.
So that's my regular TV that I watch.
Okay. Funny that you bring up Netflix. I've been tossing around the idea of canceling my Netflix.
Sure, absolutely. There's no reason to keep it.
There's not. I've noticed the only thing that we use Netflix for is The Office and at Bob's Burgers.
But they just took 3 seasons of Bob's Burgers off.
Yeah, it's just season 1 and 2 now.
Yeah.
So what am I keeping on Netflix for?
Nothing.
Right?
Yeah.
So I am debating dropping Netflix. Rarely every now and then a movie will come on I want to watch, or all the Netflix originals just don't strike me.
No.
And they may be good and I may be missing out.
Yeah.
But I'm watching so much other stuff that I don't feel like I'm getting what I'm paying for.
Right. Yeah. Like when I launched Netflix on, because I launched it on April Fool's Day just to see if they had a show.
Right.
That was the only reason. And I saw they have a whole Netflix original section, and I was fooling around like, I haven't heard of any of this shit. I might start it, but I got so much other stuff I'm busy watching, I'm never going to get around to it.
And that's kind of what it is. And I've started some of them. Like, I watched the first episode of The Crown.
Okay.
Phenomenal. I just have so much other shit to watch, I'm not watching it.
Yeah.
The other thing that's bothering me is, I don't know if you remember, Netflix used to be able to do not interested, and it stopped showing you stuff.
Yeah.
And then you would kind of curtail things that you do
that's how you got your recommendation engine.
I don't feel like I get that anymore. I know I can no longer say not interested. That is no longer an option.
Interesting.
Have you noticed that?
I don't ever launch that.
Yeah, so I can no longer say not interested. So I'm sick of Orange is the New Black. Guess what? I put that at zero stars because I didn't like it. Yet it still sells me all the time, recommended for you. And I'm just like, you know what? At this point, you're not worth it to me. Like, I own The Office on DVD. Right. So we're good here.
So the only reason that I have my Netflix account active and my Hulu account active still is because I watch shows on Kodi.
Sure.
That would be on there. So if I ever get a letter in the mail and I get called to court and be like, no, technically I'm paying for access to this content. Just because I'm not accessing it through your interface, I'm not breaking the law. I'm paying the fees.
I'm not quite sure if that's going to hold up.
I'll let you know.
Yeah, yeah, you let me know. Yeah. But yeah, so I'm just like, why do I still have Netflix? Like before.
Yeah,
I don't know. So I'm thinking about dropping it. All right. We'll see.
Now, does that mean you would drop the DVD portion
also?
No, son of a bitch.
But I use that. Like, yeah, I watch the discs more than I watch the instant streaming.
Right. Well, and that's, you have a greater array of options available on the disc than you do on instant.
I do. And as you know, my wife and I have pretty much cut out the majority of movie theaters.
Right.
So we watch a movie, two or three movies a week.
Yeah.
So by that logic, well, the discs are still good by me.
Right.
Because it's still cheaper than going to buy these movies. Now, Granted, there are some movies we buy because I know we're going to watch them several times. Some we don't. And that's just what it is. 13 hours, I loved it. One time was enough.
Yeah.
Okay. My TV is, you may have remembered last year when this happened. This year it's happened again. It is WrestleMania weekend.
Yeah, it was.
So my TV for the past 7 days have been really just centered around big, muscly men in oil.
And also wrestling.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, Every now and then you got to take a break, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So Friday was the Hall of Fame
inductees.
I was gone Friday. I was in San Francisco at a basketball game. I got back early Saturday morning. Okay. So that also interjected with me being gone. I was gone, flew out Thursday, was gone Friday, came back Saturday. But Saturday night, I made sure I watched TakeOver. And then Sunday, we watched WrestleMania.
We did. And this is the first time I've sat and watched WrestleMania in its entirety since WrestleMania 10.
So
back when you had to have the cable box.
Back when you had to have the cable box. I'm going to talk about TakeOver, then I want us to both talk about Mania.
Cool.
In regards to the comparison, I actually quite enjoy TakeOver much more than Mania.
And you had that was your opinion last year as well.
Yep. And it stands true. One, they try harder. Like they just try harder just for the sheer fact of that they are trying to make it from the minor leagues to the major leagues. And the truth of the matter is it's not like baseball or basketball where the minor leagues, you know, they're not going to make it.
Right.
If you look at LeBron James, he went out of high school to the pros.
Yeah.
That's what their superstars do.
Yeah.
They don't go to the minor leagues and hope to bump up. Right. Some baseball players do, but not all.
Right. Yeah.
Whereas in wrestling, especially WWE, you go there just to work on your mic skills, that your physical skills are already there. You're just there to work on your mic skills and how you work with other people before you go to the majors. Like, It's already known. If you're here, you're going to go here.
Yeah, yeah.
But what I like is the storylines are much shorter. They're much more concise.
Okay.
They're not drawn out over the span of sometimes 2 months.
Yeah.
Whereas in wrestling, you do have these storylines that you're like, this has been going on for 6 weeks. Guess what? I'm over this big sweaty dude wanting to fight this big sweaty dude. Why don't we just fight and call it good?
Right.
So oftentimes in NXT, you'll get 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks worth of, you know, a feud. Okay. It's going to be resolved and we're going to move on to another feud.
So it stays pretty fresh.
Very fresh. Okay. Now, we might come back and revisit it.
Sure.
But it's not going to be the only center point for this.
Okay, cool.
So it's also much less speaking, where in WrestleMania, there's not a lot of speaking.
Right.
But
there's Raw, a lot of matches, yeah.
In Raw, you're looking at half is speaking, half is wrestling. Where in NXT, you're looking at, I would say, 7/8 wrestling, 1/8 talking.
Okay. That's not too bad.
No, it's not bad at all. So I quite enjoy TakeOver. from the beginning to end, it was good.
Okay.
The right amount of time, the right amount of matches, the right winning, the right surprises. Perfect. Mania. Started at 2.
Yes.
Ended at 8.
Uh-huh.
Was it 8?
Might have been 9.
Just saying.
It was a long time.
It was a long time.
Yeah. And the first 2 hours of that was kickoff, which had matches but wasn't even the main event. It wasn't even like the WrestleMania event.
And that's something I wanted to get to. It is your 2-hour-long kickoff show. Don't add title matches in your fucking kickoff show. Right? Come on. Now, you guys missed the first kickoff match.
Which was the cruiserweight.
Yeah, which, arguably, one of the best matches of the entire night. Amazing. When you think of the high flying, the stunts, the moves they pulled while the sun in their eyes.
Yeah.
Like, there were parts where you would see. So it was Neville versus Austin Aries. Those names mean not a lot to most people. One of them's eyes is squinting as the guy's running to him because the sun they're outside in Orlando.
Yeah.
Yet they pulled this off while doing these crazy, amazing.
Okay.
Your thoughts on WrestleMania?
Like I said, this is the first WrestleMania I've seen in a long time. The first actual wrestling of any kind I've watched in a number of years. I didn't know most of the people that were wrestling, so I didn't have any predisposed opinion on who I wanted to win going into it.
Okay.
Obviously I knew a couple of the people. Like, I've been watching Undertaker for 27 years.
About 28, I think. Yeah.
So I was like, oh, cool, Undertaker's still in it. You had told me some of his recent matches were not great, so I was like, but really, I wasn't terribly impressed with much of it at all. I think the most enjoyment I got out of it was watching people come 80 yards down the entry ramp to the ring.
So the entry ramp was 80 yards. Really fast touch on the Undertaker. He'll be having hip replacement surgery in the next couple of days.
Okay.
So, like, it's there.
Yeah.
And that's kind of one of the reasons why I think NXT is a lot more fun. It's shorter. It's 2.5 hours. So you're like, okay, all right, that's digestible.
Yeah.
But I felt like the WrestleMania, everything was just kind of fine. None of it was bad. None of it was good. It just was.
Right.
I don't feel like.
I mean, the Goldberg-Lesnar fight was bad.
Yes. The Goldberg-Lesnar fight was bad. The Chris Jericho, Kevin Owens one was fine.
Yeah.
The Shane McMahon, AJ Styles was great.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But that kind of matches the way all the NXT matches are.
Okay.
I think you get to the problem with the heavyweights where they're just big bulky guys just kind of push and throw, and that's it. There's no flair to any of it.
Yeah.
So yeah, WrestleMania.
If that really was Undertaker's last match, I'm happy I got to see that, though.
So it is. They are saying that.
Well, yeah, they're saying that now. He there's other people that have retired before and they've come back. So
his last match is when he originally said, this was my last match.
Okay.
This match, like, there was that definitive send-off. That last, his other last match, as I say in quotes, didn't have that.
Okay.
This was the only time he really gave that definitive goodbye.
Okay.
So,
and I did see that his wife, Michelle McCool, was all over Twitter that night and the next day saying, thanks everybody for the great run. It's been awesome and everything like that. So, I mean, obviously they're talking like it's definitely the last one.
Yeah.
So that was cool to see.
And they did the same thing on Monday Night Raw. I know you didn't see it. The announcer started it off by thanking the Taker for his years of service and everything else. So,
that was a trending hashtag on Twitter, was thank you, Taker.
Yep.
Also in wrestling news, did you hear the Jim Ross news?
No.
He signed a 2-year contract to announce with WWE.
So he's back.
He's back, but his contract specifies which dates. So he won't be there every week, but he'll be doing select events for the next 2 years.
I believe it. He had a medical scare. I don't remember what it was.
Well, his wife died a week before WrestleMania.
Maybe that's what it was.
So everyone was, or maybe it was like 3 or 4 days, or it was within a week. So everyone was like, not only is it awesome that he's here for Undertaker's last match, but the fact that after he just lost his wife, he can still.
So I didn't know what it was. I thought it was a medical scare. I actually just assumed it was a medical scare. There were people were talking about it behind the scenes. I just know that something major happened in his life that made him reevaluate some things. That deal to do WrestleMania came through Friday.
Oh, really?
When they were doing the Hall of Fame.
Okay.
So they were talking a 2-day
wow
turnaround thing.
Yeah.
So yeah. All right. That's enough wrestle.
Okay.
Unless you got more wrestle.
I got nothing.
All right. So let's move on. You say you have some movies.
I have one movie.
Let's hear it.
I went and saw Get Out.
Okay. So my physical therapist was telling me about Get Out.
It's fucking awesome.
Okay. Tell me about it.
I'm trying to figure out how not to get in too much to spoil it. So essentially, first of all, Jordan Peele,
yes,
wrote and directed the movie. It's his directorial debut. So that's a big thing. So there's this guy who is going to see, to meet his parent or his girlfriend's parents for the first time. They're going to the parents' house over the weekend. I don't recognize the actor. The girlfriend is Allison Williams from Girls.
Okay.
Who, I don't know if you know who Brian Williams, the news anchor, is?
I do.
It's his daughter.
Yeah, like I know who connection. She. Yeah,
yeah. The people that I went to see this movie with didn't know that. They didn't know that her dad was half black or mixed race or whatever. Anyways, so the boyfriend just happens to be black. So before they go to visit the parents, he's like, "Did you tell them?" And she's like, "Tell them what? Tell them that I'm black." The girl's like, "That's not gonna be a big deal. My parents are great." Da da da. So they go up to the parents' house. On the way there, they get pulled over by a cop who's hassling the black boyfriend, and she stands up for him. She's like, "I think that's ridiculous. You know, he wasn't driving. Da, 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 da. Like, this is blatant racism and intolerance and all this stuff." They get up to the parents' house, and the guy starts realizing that all the help in the house is black. So he's like, they're like slave owners. And then just all this weird stuff happens. And you find out all these secrets about the family. And it's kind of, it's a comedy. It's a thriller movie with a lot of bits of comedy in it.
Right.
So it's done really well. I was the only person in my group that walked out of there liking the movie. And I felt bad about that.
Why?
I don't know. I'm like, does that make me less racially sensitive because of what the content of the movie is? Or do I just appreciate good movies and other people are so overly PC?
Well, and I honestly think it's the second one. The truth of the matter is, clearly it was made for that satirical purpose and to prove that point. But like you said, it was met with a comedic purpose. So
like one of the characters in the movie, so the boyfriend's friend is a TSA agent, but he's like a portly black fellow. And his character is just comedic relief. That's the entire point of the character. He's talking about how TSA knows stuff. TSA get shit done. Essentially equating them to like the NSA.
Right.
And it was funny, but everyone else is like, they just made him like a token black character. I'm like, no, they put fucking humor in it. Like, the writer and director's black. It's not like somebody's like... Yeah,
he's half black.
Well, sure.
But sure, no, and I get what you're saying, and I do think that... I think that's a problem where, I don't know, there is a term for it. Also, I apologize. No, oh. I apologize. I left my phone on and cool. ESPN is just going off the hook. I wasn't going to reference it all, but
you just broke the fourth wall there.
No, what I was going to say is, though, where, I don't remember what the term is, and there is a verbiage for it, where you it's like almost white guilt, where they were...
Yeah, that's the term, white guilt.
Yeah, so... It's got to be some of that, right? Like, it has to be.
But, I think it's a very good movie. I think the concept that they came up with for it, there probably has been instances in the past, but it's not something that's so overdone that you're like, oh, yeah, this is...
Right.
You can't predict it from the beginning. So, I definitely recommend it.
And where did you see that?
I actually saw it in the theater in the Tri-Cities.
Okay.
First experience in a theater that had the reclining couch. Or the
the reserved seats.
Yeah.
And?
It was nice. It was good. I didn't have to, you know, I was fully reclined. I didn't have to move my thing for people to get by.
Yeah.
It was great. I didn't order any of the food, but other than that, it was good.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I watched Dose movies since we last talked.
Okay.
The first one, my wife has never seen the original Friday the 13th.
Oh.
Where the mother is the murderer. Yeah. So we watched that.
Okay.
I think about 80% of it still holds up.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I was going to say like 8%.
No.
Having not seen it in a while, that would have been my assumption.
So the original Halloween holds up.
Okay.
This one also holds up.
Interesting.
So
Now, holds up in the sense that it's like the same as it was then, because even back then it was kind of super campy and not scary, or like it's a good thriller.
It's still a good thriller and it's still a good movie.
Okay.
The effects are obviously dated.
Well, sure.
So you have to disregard that, right? But I feel like anything, every 5 years, effects become dated.
Yeah.
Like, I think if you ever go watch The Matrix, you'd be like, wow, this is kind of dated.
Right.
So the effects, you have to throw that aside. You know, obviously you have to throw the clothes aside, because you have to throw the era aside.
Right.
But as a movie, it's still a good movie. Like, she didn't see it coming that it was the mom was the murderer. Okay. You know what I mean?
And yeah.
Some of the scenes still, like, she jumped at him, and I still enjoyed it. So I think that holds up.
Awesome.
What I did not enjoy was Mighty Morphin Power Rangers.
Oh, don't tell me that. I haven't watched it yet.
Yeah. So I'm going to touch lightly on it, since you haven't watched it, and it's you're going to watch it.
Yeah, I'm going
to
watch it this weekend.
Yeah, there you go. You know what? I'm going to hold off then.
Okay.
We'll talk about it when you watch it.
Okay, cool.
Anything else before we get to our beloved comic books? Because I have those.
You do?
I almost have like 2 weeks worth here.
Yeah. No, I got nothing else.
Because it is 2 weeks worth here. It is
2 weeks worth, yeah.
Okay. So, once again, my shipment was delayed.
Digital.
So, what I do have in front of me is the news issue previews.
Wow, how much did you pay for that?
$1.50.
Oh, I was kidding. You actually have to pay for that shit?
Yeah.
Oh. All right.
You're
paying $1.50 to get spoilers. That's pretty bad.
I'm actually really, really happy that I get previews.
Okay.
Because it's actually introduced me to a lot of indie books that Fair I wouldn't enough. Otherwise have gotten.
Okay.
For instance, the Black Hammer trade paperback.
Okay.
Written by Jeff Lemire, art by Dean Ormston.
I've heard of this book. I have not read it yet. I don't think.
So what I've really done really with the previews and indie books is I read the previews. I don't read the DC or the Marvel sections.
Okay.
I look just at the title names, and that's it.
Okay.
I don't read the descriptions. But when it comes to the indie stuff, I look at the new ones.
Fair enough.
And if it intrigues me, I order issue one.
Okay.
So that way, I'm not buying, you know, the trade's $14.99. I'm not buying $14.99 just on an assumption. I've read that first issue and said, I like that. I want that in trade format.
Okay, cool.
So that's really why I get the previews.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, I got the Black Hammer Secret Origins trade paperback volume 1. Wiped out of their superhero universe by a multiverse crisis, the forgotten heroes of Spiral City now live in a dysfunctional family on a mysterious farm in a small town from which they have no escape.
I feel like I either read the first issue or a book that I read had a preview of that, because that sounds familiar.
It's really good. I enjoyed it.
Okay.
I also have Batman number 20, Nightwing number 18 with both covers, Superman number 20, Titans Annual number 1, Green Lantern Space Ghost number 1.
Yeah.
The infamous Iron Man number 6, X-Men Prime number 1,
mm-hmm.
X-Men Gold number 1.
Yep.
All New Wolverine 19, Royals number 1, Inhuman Prime number 1, Little Archie and His Pals.
Shut up, is that?
Yeah, it is.
Oh.
It sure
is. I need to go pick that up.
It is by Art Balzar and Franco.
Yeah.
So
their Tiny Titans was one of my favorite comics.
Titans is amazing.
So
they've done a bunch of other ones. They've done Little Hellboy and Little This, but come on. Little Archie and His Pals, I'm in.
I'm going to have to go get that.
Riverdale number 1.
Oh, why would you do that?
So
have you read it yet?
No.
Okay.
So here's why I did it. And here's every now and then where previews bites you in the ass. This was solicited before the show came out. And I'm like, yeah, I'll get the first issue.
Mm-hmm.
Again, just ordered issue number 1. James Bond number 2. James Bond Hammerhead number 6. G.I. Joe, A Real American Hero 238.
Okay.
In the book I want to talk about today, Jughead, The Hunger.
Fucking zombie Jughead?
No.
Okay.
It was super good.
Okay.
Super good.
So here's what I read for this week. I don't have my last week's books because I read them last week.
Yeah, because you got one.
I don't have delay issues. So this week I got Batman number 20, Green Arrow number 20, Green Lanterns number 20, Nightwing 18, They're Not Like Us number 15, X-Men Gold number 1. And since the last time we recorded, I read the entire Double Take line, which is 50 comics. Each one's about 120 pages.
What?
But not really, because they're like, what is Marvel's digital format? Infinity Comic?
Yeah.
So where each page isn't really a full page, yeah, just a little bit of movement on a page.
Maybe an addition of a word bubble or a removal of a
word
bubble.
So the Double Take universe is, it's 10 books, 5 issues each, and they all take place in just outside of Pittsburgh, I think, or rural Pennsylvania, where there's suddenly a zombie outbreak, and then you find out it's actually aliens, but it's not aliens, it's people from Venus, but it's not people from Venus.
Who writes this?
So I don't recognize any of the creators. Double Take is its own publishing house.
Right.
This is all they've ever published.
Is it Dan Schneider, something like that? Is he one of the writers? It
could be. Okay. I don't know. But yeah, so I read all 50 issues of that.
And?
The first three or four issues of each one were really good. I could not tell you how it ended, though. So part of the problem is... all the issues kind of overlap. So you'd be like, you'd read one issue and there'd be like a news broadcast as part of the story. And then you'd read another issue and you'd hear, or they'd have the news broadcast in the background. So you knew it was all one universe.
Oh, interesting.
But the way I did it is I read all of the number ones, then all of the number twos, then all of the number threes. But they didn't necessarily go chronologically in that order. So it could have been like 1, 2, 3 of this issue and then one of this issue.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
So
it you was read super... it. You needed a reading list.
Yeah. And it has dates on there. So it would be like this part of the story is on April 22nd. And this issue would be like this part of the story is on April 22nd at this time, which is 2 hours later. So it was there, but it would have taken way too much work to be like, oh, I can't read this yet. I got to read that one first. So I just read them through. And yeah, at one point there was an... separatist human colony on Venus.
That sounds right.
Because Venus isn't actually inhospitable like we think it is. They just have a projection of the atmosphere, and anytime things come into the atmosphere, they just shoot it down. Yeah, it's super weird.
Okay. But is it weirder than Jughead, Hunger, which is one of the Archie horror books?
Okay.
So the other Archie horror books we're familiar with are The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina.
Okay.
And you had mentioned also The Afterlife with Archie, the zombie one.
Right.
Okay. So Jughead the Hunger is just a one-shot story.
Okay.
Where, I'm going to read you the synopsis. Jughead Jones has always had an insatiable appetite, but what if his hunger was worse than anyone realized? Descending from a lycanthropic lineage.
Oh, shut up.
The unassuming Jughead harbors a deep, dark secret. He is a werewolf.
Fuck that.
And when a murderous menace is on the prowl, taking the lives of some of the inhabitants of Riverdale, Jughead and his family's dark legacy comes to light. And it's up to werewolf hunter Betty Cooper to put him to a stop.
No.
Oh,
no.
My God. So,
how was this good?
Oh, my God. It was amazing. It was amazing.
Was it, like, amazing in reality or ironically amazing?
In reality.
Oh.
So here's why I love the Archie horror books. They have come to terms that they don't have to be any real lineage. They don't have to honor any of the Archie stuff whatsoever, because it exists entirely in its own universe.
Sure. Yeah.
So this Jughead the Hunger one shot, everything about it exists in its universe.
Okay.
Because if you can't even refer to it as Afterlife with Archie, because in Afterlife with Archie, Jughead already got killed.
Okay.
So it does exist solely by itself. So think of it as a story with the Riverdale group.
It's a Riverdale what if.
Yes, yeah. It really is. And so it starts off with, they called it the Riverdale Ripper.
Oh, jeez.
People are dying by the Riverdale Ripper. And you see it right away. Like, okay. Ms. Grundy's head is off.
Yeah.
So we know that he's killed Pops. He's killed Ms. Grundy. He's killed, who else has died? His poor cousin Bingo. So, and it's funny. Like, it's really funny. It's all the characters you realize. He doesn't know he's a werewolf either.
Okay.
Archie finds out about halfway through the book, because he sees him transforming and killing somebody, and he thinks he's going to find a way to protect him. And that's when you find out Betty is a descendant of vampire, of werewolf hunters.
Oh, jeez.
And has infiltrated the group just because she knows there's a werewolf in Riverdale but couldn't find it. And then she realized it was Jughead. So they show all this crazy ass like back lineage and story to both of them. And then they try to cure Jughead, but you realize they don't. So at the end, he ends up killing Reggie, like it was foreshadowed in the beginning of the book, and him just leaving town with Hot Dog, his dog, and Betty vowing to hunt him down.
Oh, jeez. Okay.
It was really fun.
It sounds all right. Yeah.
It was fun.
Okay. So I noticed you had Green Lantern Space Ghost in your stuff.
Yes.
Have you read it?
No. Okay. So I, for
you
those of
you haven't read any of these yet.
No. So for those of you who don't know, like I picked up my books. For the five of you that this matters to, I ran from downtown Seattle to Redmond to Mount Lake Terrace, and then you got here like maybe 10 minutes after
okay.
I did.
Okay. Cool.
So Jughead the Hunger.
So, what is your exposure to Space Ghost?
Obviously, Space Ghost, Ghost to Ghost.
Uh-huh.
And I remember Space Ghost cartoons before that.
Okay.
I don't think this is going to be Coast to Coast. I think it's going to be Space Ghost before that.
It is.
Is it really Coast to Coast?
No. Okay. It's before that. And okay. I was super disappointed because I was really hoping for Coast to Coast.
That's what you had said.
Yeah, and it wasn't.
I didn't think
and
so.
And Brack.
Is it the villain?
Brack or Zorak. One of them shows up. And again, I was hoping it was Coast to Coast version, and it's not at all. So I was actually really disappointed.
Oh, I'm sorry, man.
But I think it's only a one shot.
It is a one shot.
So
absolutely.
I don't have to deal with any more than that.
No.
But yeah, I was kind of let down because I gave myself false expectations.
You got yourself all riled up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
this
do you read Future Quest?
No.
Okay. I was gonna ask what he's liking that, but if you don't read it, never mind.
No, I dropped that book. That's one of the books where previews got me the first issue, and that was one enough for me.
Yeah. So. Kind of disappointing, but
I think it's gonna be
the
great.
Art's really good though.
Yeah, the art looked amazing. Are you kidding me?
Yeah,
Sabella.
And I'm trying to remember.
Olivetti.
Chris Sabella did the colors, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nope, that's awesome.
So. All
right. Well, okay. that is it for me this week.
That's all I got.
We'll be back next week.
As far as I know.
No reason not to be, unless I don't get my books.
Yeah.
And you know, if I don't have my books, we'll talk about Black Hammer, I guess.
All right. Cool.
Bye.
See you.